tonight.
I was a fairly active person physically.
I was feeling fine. No signs at all that this was going to happen.
An ABC 27 special presentation.
Until you have a neurological event, most people have no idea that they have carotid artery disease.
Penn State Hershey Neuroscience Institute presents Brain Power, Carotid Artery Disease. Brought to you by Penn State Milton S. Hershey Medical Center.
Good evening, I'm Chuck Rhodes. Stroke is the third leading cause of death in the United States. Every year, about 795,000 people in the United States have a stroke. Carotid artery disease is often the cause. The New England Journal of Medicine concluded that in the ultrasound scanning of carotid arteries is the single best predictor of stroke and heart disease.
A Lancaster County man was in tip-top shape when suddenly he keeled over at a bank. He didn't know what was happening until doctors told him he had a stroke. Exercise is a big part of Frank Burns' life, and his wife Ann keeps right up with him. If they're not walking their Greyhounds, they're biking or running, and that's how they met.
We were both runners, and I met her in Central Park and through some friends, and that's where it started.
Over the years, Frank competed in 8 marathons, including New York City's, with a time of 2 hours, 50 minutes. He's placed in numerous 5K runs.
Frank is the paragon of fitness.
So fit, so healthy. Frank thought so too, until 3 years ago when he was in New York City.
I went out for a jog, ran about 4 miles, and everything was fine. I had no symptoms of anything. But then it just hit me. My left hand was so numb, something dropped out. I had some papers that dropped out onto the ground. I went to retrieve them, and I keeled over, and that's when they called the ambulance and I was taken to the hospital.
I was here at home in Lancaster, and I got a call from the emergency room in Elmhurst Hospital, and the doctor said that Frank had had a stroke. I was shocked. Frank is a healthy, fit person. I know he had hypertension, but it was well controlled, and it was just hard to believe that this could have happened to Frank.
They ran a whole series of tests, and they were pretty convinced I had blockage in the carotid artery, and that's what caused the stroke. A clot broke off from there and went to my brain.
Frank contacted Dr. Robert Harbaugh at Penn State Hershey Neuroscience Institute.
This is a case of severe right carotid artery stenosis, as was the case for Mr. Byrne. And what it demonstrates is the common carotid artery dividing into an external carotid going to the face and scalp and an internal carotid going to the brain. Right here at the origin, it's very, very narrow. You can hardly see any contrast going across.
80 to 90% of the carotid artery was blocked.
He was at very high risk for another potentially disabling stroke because of the fact that he was symptomatic and had a high degree of stenosis, narrowing of the vessel. And I told him I thought it was essential to go ahead and get that carotid artery fixed.
Dr. Harbaugh knew the best surgical solution.
It's a carotid endarterectomy, and it's actually opening up the artery and cleaning out the plaque that's built up over many years, washing the artery out thoroughly and then closing it back up.
I wasn't disturbed by the prospect of the surgery. I was happy because then I would avoid the same thing again. And that's why I wanted to get it done.
It would reduce the chances of him having a repeat stroke. So that to me was a lifeline.
He's sort of the ideal patient to operate on, but one that I don't see too often. He's very thin and in good shape, and is actually a really straightforward operation.
Dr. Harbaugh came down and told me that, you know, things went well, and of course Frank didn't have general anesthesia, so he was awake and I could go to the recovery room and see him.
Frank spent one night in the hospital. A week later, he was active again.
He's able to run, and he's active, and I think that he's done really well.
I still can do things, go to the gym, do weights and whatever, run and swim and things like that without any real effect.
And Frank told me after the surgery, 3 months after the surgery, he and his wife Ann went on a biking vacation in Greece. There they bike 50 to 60 miles a day. Frank says that from the stroke, he does have some numbness in his fingers and his left side is weaker, but it's not stopping him from doing the things he loves. Back to you, Chuck.
Doesn't look like it at all. That's amazing. Well, joining us now is Dr. Robert Harbaugh in the studio. And Doctor, let's begin with the basic question. What is carotid artery disease?
Well, the carotid arteries are major arteries in the neck carrying blood to the brain. And it's possible to develop a buildup of plaque that narrows the arteries. And if that becomes severe enough, it can lead to clots forming, breaking off, going downstream and causing a stroke.
Okay, well, let's begin with that then. What happens to a person when they have a stroke?
Well, there are two kinds of stroke. Hemorrhagic strokes are bleeding in the brain. That's less common. And the kind of stroke we'll be talking about tonight is an ischemic stroke, a loss of blood flow to a part of the brain. And if a portion of the brain loses its blood flow, that portion of the brain stops working. So if it's the part of the brain that allows you to speak, you can no longer speak. Mm. If it's the part that allows you to use your right hand, you can't use your right hand. And if you have a complete loss of blood flow for as short a period of time as 5 minutes to any part of the brain at normal body temperature, that part of the brain dies.
Okay, now how do you diagnose this disease? And I have a question, is it different for male or female when you diagnose this?
Right. Well, very often people don't know they have carotid artery disease, and the diagnosis isn't made until a stroke or a TIA, warning symptom of a stroke, occurs. In some other patients, if they have a risk profile, they have risk factors that we know leads to narrowing of the arteries, they can be evaluated before a stroke occurs with various types of imaging modalities to see if they do have a narrow carotid artery.
Now, some have diagnosed, is it ever safe to let this go untreated?
I think to find carotid artery disease and not treat it at all is a mistake. Most of these patients can be treated, especially if they're asymptomatic, can be treated with medical management without any invasive procedures.
Let's talk about some of those treatments. What would we be facing as a patient?
Right. Well, if someone's found to have carotid artery disease, I think the most important thing is to manage the risks. If the person is a smoker, to stop smoking. If he or she has diabetes, to manage the diabetes, control blood pressure, make sure that the cholesterol levels are appropriate, and all of those sorts of management things are medical in nature. In some patients, in addition to the medical management, you may want to treat the carotid artery disease either with endovascular treatment or surgery.
All right, we'll talk about some more of those treatment options.
Now, joining us here in the call center to help answer the viewer questions is Dr. Kevin Cockcroft. Thanks for joining us tonight.
Thank you.
Here is the first viewer question. My grandmother has hardening of the arteries. Is this hereditary?
Yes, it is. It can be. Many patients will have a family history of carotid artery disease. If it turns out that your family members had this problem when they were very young, then that's a risk factor for you also having that problem.
And they should talk to their doctor?
Yes. It turns out there are many tests that we can do, as simple as a physical examination in the doctor's office to maybe tell if you have that disease, or even some simple tests, which are non-invasive and no risk to you.
Okay, and here is the second question. I'm 41 years old, exercise regularly, and eat healthy. Why do I have problems with high cholesterol?
Well, that's kind of related to the previous question. This person may actually have a problem in family history, so they have a genetic predisposition to having this carotid artery disease. Now, that doesn't mean that the other things that they do, the diet, exercise, and all that, are not still important. They are still very important, and those things are actually more common causes of carotid artery disease than the hereditary part.
Okay, thanks so much, and we'll check back with you in a few more minutes with more viewer questions, but we'll send it back to you in the studio, Chuck.
Thank you, Deborah, and again, I'm with Dr. Harbaugh, and let's talk about one of the basic ingredients in this problem seems to be cholesterol. A lot of lay people think they know something about it, and that's probably dangerous in itself. Tell me the difference between what we call good cholesterol, bad cholesterol, and is high cholesterol, is that a risk for this disease?
Right. Well, the cholesterol profile that a patient has, total cholesterol, the ratio between the high-density lipoprotein or good cholesterol and the low-density lipoprotein or bad cholesterol is also important. So part of the medical management of carotid artery disease will be to try to normalize the cholesterol and make that ratio better to reduce the risk of stroke.
What are some of the other risk factors? There has to be a laundry list of these things.
Right. Well, there's smoking, which is a huge factor. There's hypertension, high blood pressure. Diabetes is a factor. And then there are risk factors that you can't do anything about, like age and family history. And people who have the whole range of risk factors, high blood pressure, diabetes, high cholesterol, smoke, positive family history, may well develop carotid artery disease in their 30s or 40s. Mm. If you have no risk factors, it doesn't mean you won't develop carotid artery disease, but it's usually much later in life.
Okay. Well, thank you, doctor. And